The best way to learn pyplot is through examples. Let us start by looking at some line plots. Let me show you the data first. Here I have a data of four columns. The first column is the number of bytes. I'm dealing with a flash storage system which has a certain read time, write time, and an operation called synchronization, sync time, for various block sizes. So I want to plot these various metrics, read time, write time, and sync time, as a function of the block size. I want a graph which looks something like this: number of bytes in the x-axis, and these three metrics as a function of the number of bytes, this latency, read time, write time, and sync time as a function of this x-axis, the number of bytes. Let me now show you the pyplot script which I have used to create this graph. It is quite simple actually. This script has several sections. The first is the section which reads the input file, this CSV file. For that I am using the CSV library, and I am converting what I read into a matrix of the different rows, and I have a dictionary of column name to column index. So these are the different column names: num bytes, read time, write time, and sync time. I want my script to be independent of the order of the columns. So I have a mapping from column name to index in a dictionary called I, capital I, and a matrix of the remaining rows. And I have a section for plot configuration section. Let's come back to that a little bit later. Let me show you the plotting section first. Here, this bytes column is something I extract out of this matrix representing the data. So this is the x-axis, and this is the core of the plot function. For each of the metrics that I want to plot, I have a plt.plot, x-axis, y-axis. Each of these is a list. Now this plt is something which I import from matplotlib, which is a library for plotting in Python. And the rest of the arguments to this plot function call are all details, the various details which are important while plotting. I need a label for that particular plot within a graph. Each of those lines in the graph I am calling a plot. So the graph has three plots, one corresponding to each of the metrics. So the label for a plot is the same as the name of the column. Then I specify a line style for the plot. This line style, here in the code I have a dictionary as a function of the column name again. So the line style values are either a single dash or a double dash or a dash followed by a dot, and you can see what they translate to in the final graph. Here read time, that is the single dash, double dash is this write time, and sync time is this dash followed by dot. Those are the three different line styles. And the colors I have specified as red, blue, and black. And the markers for each of the points within the line, a cross, a plus, and an O. The marker size can be specified, and the marker edge width, the width with which these markers are drawn, that is the MEW, marker edge width, and the line width itself for each of these plots. So these are only a subset of the different configuration options. You can configure more, but these are the ones which are necessary for minplots I plot. So this is an example. After specifying this plot command, I can specify x label for the graph, y label for the graph, and here I have called a grid function on this plt object with the argument b equal to on, which means that these grids are turned on. And then I have a legend for the graph. Legend is nothing but this portion of the graph, and I have specified LOC equals 0, which if you look at the documentation means that pyplot will use its internal logic to figure out the best position for the legend. And then I call this savefig function on this plt object. I want to save it to this PDF file it figures out the format in which to save based on the extension. And here I have specified that I want tight bounding. That means I don't want any extra spaces around the graph, and that's it. So when I run this script, it will generate this graph. I had already run it, and that is the graph you're looking at. And that's how this graph is generated. Quite simple, isn't it? Many times you want to do data analysis and look at different parts of the graph in various amounts of detail. In MATLAB, you can do this easily, and you can do this easily in Pyplot as well. Let me show you how you can do that. I'll have to do this plt.show. Let me save this file, and when I run it now, it pops up this window, which I can zoom into a certain part, zoom in further, unzoom, and from this it has a menu option to save as well. So I can do all these things. It has option also to view multiple graphs if there were multiple graphs. In my script I have only one, so these buttons are not useful. So that's how you can do data analysis online by using Pyplot. I have shown you only part of the API so far. The entire API specification you can look up online. The website is matplotlib.org, and the entire API specification is given here. So if you search for example, .plot, this is the entire specification of the plot function. There is also a convenient tutorial and very, very convenient thumbnail gallery, which you can browse through to look at what sort of graph you want to plot and what code you can use for plotting that. As you can see, there's a whole set of examples available to choose from. Let me show you another example with a few more features. For this example, I'm going to use another data file which has four columns of values with various records, one record per line, and these are the different metrics which I want to plot: 5th percentile, 95th percentile, a band, and a median. Here is my Pyplot code for plotting the same. The data reading part is quite similar to what I showed earlier. Then the plot configuration is also similar. One difference you see in the plot call is that I specify only one column here, and this is interpreted to be the y-axis, and the x-axis is implicit as the record number. And like earlier, I specify various properties of the plot: the label, the line style, the color, the marker, marker size, marker edge width, line width as earlier. Now let's plot this and see how it looks. So here is how it looks. I want to show you a couple of other features. One is the specification of ymax. You can similarly specify ymin, xmin, xmax as well in a function called to this plot.axis. Now let's see what happens when I do that. I hit Ctrl R to reload this, and you can see that the y-axis is now set to minus 70 is the ymax. Let me show you the next feature now, which is plt.figure function call. Now in a particular graph, you can have multiple sub-figures. By default, there is only one figure. By making function calls to this figure function call, you can specify multiple figures. I am still here generating only one figure per graph. However, I am using this figure function call to specify the figure size to be 8 inches by 4 inches. Let me save this and see what happens when I run it. When I reload, I see that this graph has become a bit flatter. I also see that this legend is not quite placed properly. So let me introduce another feature. in this legend function call, you can specify this additional argument as number of columns. Here I'm specifying the number of columns as 3, by default it is 1. So when I save it and run it again, I can see that now the legend looks much better by spreading it out into 3 columns. So those are some of the features of line plots. You can learn many more by looking at the various examples online as well as the API. Bar plots are another common way to visualize data. Let's see how to draw some bar plots using some examples using PyPlot. Here is the data. It has 3 columns, node ID and a metric called overflow and another metric called retry limit. And let us say this is the kind of graph that I want to visualize from that. One corresponding to the overflow, another corresponding to the retry limit, and another third bar corresponding to the sum of those two for each of the node IDs. To draw this, here is the PyPlot script I have. The initial part is quite similar, the CSV file reading. The data is broken up into multiple columns. Here you can see I am using lambda functions to derive the total of the overflow and retry limit matrix. And then I am using the NumPy library to get an array, not a list of numbers. The array of numbers is of the same length as the number of entries in the file which I have just read. That is this IND. IND represents an array here. Here is the call to the bar function, which is responsible for plotting the bars. One bar for the total in red color, one bar for the overflow metric in white color, and the hatch style I can specify. The hatching is the shading within the bar, and a third bar corresponding to the retry limit metric in the data. And you can see that these are offset by a certain amount, that is the width which I have specified here to be 0.2. This part is quite similar to what we had in the line plot, axis specification, x label, y label, grid. And here I have a specification of x ticks. So the node ID column actually gets specified as the x ticks here. It is not used anywhere else in the plotting. So these node IDs take on the values of the x ticks. These are the ticks in the x axis. That is the values which appear in the x axis that I want at this IND plus 1.5 times the width. And then the legend specification is also slightly different. I am using these objects which are returned by the bar function calls, using a list of those, and for each element of the list I have a legend specification as given by the second list here. So the legend function call is slightly different from what we had earlier, and the end result of this we have already seen. Let me show it to you now, and this is the graph which gets generated. Let me show another feature here. Many times it is useful to visualize two different metrics, both as a function of the same x-axis. If you want to visualize two different metrics, it doesn't make sense to have only one y-axis. So we have one y-axis on the left side, and we also use the right side y-axis in the graph being plotted. So the graph will look something like this. So here I have a system where the parameter is the queue size, and there are two different metrics. One is the queue overflow percentage and another is the utilization percentage of the server. So as you can see, the y-axis is different from the y2 axis. This axis here goes by the name of y2 axis. In this case, both of them happen to be dimensionless percentages, but we could also have here a metric of a completely different dimension or unit. both represented as a function of the same x-axis variable, in this case the queue size. Here is the data corresponding to what I just showed, the queue size, various utilization values and the queue overflow values for different levels of error percentage. The details of the data are not important. It's a CSV file, much like what we have been using earlier. Pay specific attention here to the plotting functionalities. These are all the different data manipulation aspects which we have already seen. So this is the code for extraction of Y2. I make a function call to subplots and get plt.twinx, that is the Y2 axis. Now I am going to plot y1 dot something and likewise plot y2 dot something else. If you notice here, the y1 axis is using for the list of y-axis values the queue overflow percentages, data extracted from the same text file, and the y2 dot plot function is using the utilization percentage values, again a different column extracted from the same text file. These plot function calls are quite similar to what we encountered earlier in the line plots. One difference here is that I am using the return value as well. The return value happens to be a list, the specification of which you can find in the documentation, but what is important here is that the first element of the list which is returned is a line object, and I am maintaining here a list of the various lines which are getting plotted. In this lines list, both the y1 lines and the y2 lines I am appending to this lines list. I will be using that shortly. So these commands are quite self-explanatory. Set x label, set y label, setting the color of the various axes and labels, setting the color of the tick parameters, and setting ymax and ymin for y1 and y2 axes respectively, setting the grid, and here is where we use the lines list while plotting the legend. So I have an array of lines and then I do l.getLabel for l in lines, so that is the array of labels, rather the list of labels, that is the second argument to this legend, and I am specifying here a specific location for the legend. So in this case I happen to find that convenient. So this is the x and y axis locations where the legend must be placed, and I am also specifying a particular font size for the legend by using this prop equal to feature, and with that I can now run the code, and this is the graph which gets generated. Another commonly used feature is a log scale on one of the axes or both the axes. Let me show you an example. Here is the data which I want to plot. Three columns specified in comma separated value format again. Here is the script I have, like earlier, initial portion of the code for parsing the data. And this is the x-axis column. And the two different metrics given in the second and third columns of the data I want to plot. This is the plot call, very much like earlier. Let's see what happens now. This is the graph which gets generated, and as shown here, most of the data is getting smooshed to the left. I want more resolution in the data, and it is in these kind of situations that log plots help. So I want a logarithmic scale on the x-axis, and I want more resolution in the y-axis as well. So I'm going to use a log-log plot. Here is how I'm going to change the function calls. plt.loglog will make it a log-log plot. Let's now see what happens. Now I have a log-log plot. As you can see, the graph looks much better with very good resolution along both the x-axis and y-axis. One aspect of this graph which I would like changed is that the scientific notation of the x and y ticks sometimes makes the graph somewhat unreadable. So I would like normal notation here. To do that, I have to use the scalar formatter imported from another library and use the scalar formatter as the format for x and y axis. This is the function call for doing the same. Once I do that, let's see how it looks. Much better. Let me now show you an example of how we can place some text within a graph at arbitrary locations. I will use this example where I have these text for different bars. So different groups of bars, I have some text associated with that. Here I'm indicating that these set of bars are for this particular parameter value, SNR equal to 13 dB, and these set of bars are for another parameter value, and so on. Here is the script for doing the same. The bar plot calls are similar to earlier, and here are the extra calls which I have used here. I have specified a particular position for the text and the text which has to be placed in that particular position. And the result of running that is this graph. Another common feature in various graphs is to show error bars. These are common when you are showing measurement errors. Let's see an example of that. These are the kind of error bars I want to show. For that, here is the script I have. In the script, the initial part is the data reading, which is quite similar to what we have seen already, the extraction of the various columns. So instead of a call to the plot function call, I have a call to the error bar function of the PLT object. And the relevant arguments here are these three columns, the X column, the Y column, and another column which I specified here as Y error. That is interpreted as the error bar. And when I plot this, this is what I get. So this concludes our short run through of the various features of PyPlot. And as I have shown on the website, there are many more features which you can look at from the various examples given online, as well as from the API documentation.